for me.
Yeah.
I'm gonna go Stones.
Yeah, solid though.
It's hard to look past Maguire, even though I don't rate Maguire that highly. I'm not gonna go Maguire. I'm gonna go Stones. Because I want to throw some curveballs in there, you know what I mean? Again, he might not even get in the full 26, but I'm going to go Stones and Mings.
Okay, all right.
That random, innit? You know what I mean? Stones and Mings, putting him in there.
Yeah.
And then my wing-backs. This is where it gets hard, because these wing-backs are going to get cut. And I don't know, like, I want Trent to play.
Yeah, yeah.
Like... Who did you say?
I thought Kyle Walker right back.
Over Trent.
Just because I don't think England are gonna have the ball the same. If England are controlling possession, then I'm going Trent. But if they're not gonna have the ball, I'm gonna go Kyle Walker.
I'm gonna go Trent then. And Luke Shaw.
Yeah, you gotta have Luke Shaw in there, bro.
That's my foot. I've only got five down. This is hard.
This
is why he gets paid the big bucks for this stuff. Jesus. And then in the middle, I'm going to go 4-3-3 as well. And this is where it gets difficult. Big up the ice cream man as well.
That's vintage.
This is where it gets difficult because in the provisional squad announcement, they've got Jack Grealish listed as a forward. But like, and Phil Foden as a forward. Do you know what I mean? It's like, but obviously, these guys play centre attacking mid.
Yeah.
Or they can play more than that, but that's where I would play them. Then I'm going to... All right, my midfield three then. I'm going to go Jordan Henderson, providing the steal. I'm going to go Mason Mount. Oh, this is where it gets hard. All right, I'm going to go Jordan Henderson, Mason Mount, and then I'm going to put Phil Foden in there or Jack Grealish. Oh my god,
I thought Jack Grealish on the left,
in the front three. So because Phil Foden's more suited to play in the middle, I think. So I'm gonna go Phil Foden there, and then up top obviously Harry Kane, that's done. And so then it's another two. I'm gonna go Grealish and Sterling.
What, you said no place of Rashford in the starting 11?
I think Rashford's been...
I think Rashford's been...
That's my 11, but...
Interested.
You know, good luck editing that together. Jesus Christ.
Yeah. All good. Euro talk. All good, man. Anyway, man, we've got a couple of more topics to talk about. Let's move on from football a bit. We're going to have a little talk about the old boxing, eh, mate?
Okay.
That's a quick one. I remember, like, you invited me to an event a while back, man. Where was we at?
The Ultimate Boxer.
Yeah. I just done a red carpet that day, you know, for the Intent movie.
Oh, no, not the Ultimate Boxer. It was I invited you to an underground fan club.
Yeah.
And it was like me,
David Hay.
Steve Bunce.
Honourable shout out, big broadcaster.
Darren Harriott, he's a comedian, and we were just like...
Flair East
was DJing, and it was basically like...
vibes.
I was hosting this event, and it was like a Q&A and stuff like that. You came down, though, you were there.
Yeah, I was there. I know, I was like... But I was just so... That's when I was like, run, Nick's proper, like... He's versatile with it, you know. That's when I was like...
Man, you got to be.
Well-seasoned, and it was a really good interview with David Hay, and that's one of my favourite iconic British boxers, man.
I'm lucky enough to have met David Hay a few times. Yeah. So it's like, that helps, you know, that I had a bit of a relationship with him prior to the interview and that. So, that it was cool, because it was in a posh hotel in East London, and... there was like an audience, so we were doing games and stuff like that, but then there was like the Q&A section and I think, did you ask a question?
I think something about, I'm trying to think, did he fight by then? How do you thought what's his name, Tony Bellew by then? I don't think he had fought Tony Bellew.
I can't even remember the question.
It was a while back, man.
Yeah, it was ages ago.
But the questions were just his career questions about, you know, his whole life story, how he came into boxing, and it just the way you guided the interview was really nice, man. See,
respect, man.
The champ, you know, David Haye, you know, he don't sometimes he don't get his flowers enough, you know.
Yeah,
He done some coming from cruiserweight and then
becoming it's not easy,
jumping divisions and you know, coming two weight champion.
But to go up to cruiser, yeah, people don't realize because obviously that's what Usyk's doing now,
yeah,
isn't it?
AJ. Sports with
Blake. On Dan Blake TV on YouTube.
Yeah, like coming up from cruiser to heavyweight, it ain't easy, bruv. Yeah. Like, because most natural heavyweights, you know, Deontay Wilders of the world, Tyson Furies, Anthony Joshua's, they're big guys.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And they don't need to try to make the weight because they just are the weight.
Yeah, they are.
You know what I mean? Whereas a lot of the cruiserweights coming up, one of the things that David Haye was telling me when I interviewed him at his gym in Bermondsey,
Haymaker gym and that.
He was saying to me, like, he used to, that was one of the things he used to find the hardest.
Yeah.
Because you would have to eat like a horse to make that weight. To be heavy enough. You know what I mean? Like,
you're definitely a natural cruiser.
It messes with you as well, because obviously I feel like as humans, you know, everybody can go to the gym and try to get wedge and blah, 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 but you just have a natural weight.
Natural weight, 100%.
You know what I mean? Yeah, you have a natural kind of, and like if you're trying to go up, like, it's not easy. It can mess with how cut you are. Yeah, you know what I mean? How fast or slow you move. But he managed to do it and obviously win a world title.
Yeah, but I remember he would say that he would eat so many meals a day to kind of maintain that kind of frame.
Yeah,
trust me. Thought he was definitely, David Haye was a natural cruiserweight.
Yeah.
But he probably had to eat a lot of meals to kind of maintain that shape and train a lot and keep rehydrating a lot and that kind of thing. So
the issue with cruiser is the money.
Yeah,
you know,
not that glamorous division, is it?
Everybody wants to go up to heavies because you know that's where the peas are at.
Yeah,
you know, so like, Usyk now is literally following in the footsteps of David Haye.
Yeah,
and you know, prior to that, Tony Bell, you did it a couple of times, didn't he? When he fought David Haye, was that heavy or was that a cruiser?
That was a heavyweight.
Yeah,
that was a heavyweight.
So, because I think it just adds. It adds a few more zeros onto the check, do you know what I mean?
Everyone, the heavyweight, it's the glamorous division, right?
It's like the 100 metres in the Olympics, you know, it's the one that people turn their eyes to. So, I can only imagine, because I'm someone who's always struggled to put on weight. Mm. Like, I've always been like quite a slim guy, and I can only imagine how difficult it would be to get up to, you know, heavyweight.
But then there's an honourable shout out to him, because I remember. Big shout out to my mate Craig Spider Richards. He's the British light heavyweight champion. I remember I was at a press conference of him ages ago, early parts of his career. It was like a weigh-in, and I think Lawrence Okoli was there at the time. And I remember his sister coming up to me saying, "Yeah, this guy, keep an eye on this guy. He's going to be big in the future."
Who, Okoli?
At the time, and he was just coming. I think his first two fights, and. Look, he's a cruiserweight, and look how he just become the cruiserweight world champion.
But he'll go to heavy.
He'll move to
heavy. You
he's
know.
Huge already.
Yeah.
He's huge in the flesh as well. Like, you're like, bloody hell, mate. Like, you ain't going to stay at cruiserweight.
I saw him on the train once. Yeah. I've interviewed him a couple of times, actually, but I saw him on the train once on the way back from Manchester. Yeah, and big guy. I mean, you'd have to be a big guy to, if you're going to go out with Ms. Banks, who's quite a tall girl. Yeah, yeah. Like, you got to be a big guy, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
so you can't be Marga, 5 foot, 5 foot 5 dude dating Miss Banks. That'll look wild, you know what I mean?
Yeah, honourable shout out to her, because when I was going Craig's fights, Craig and Lawrence, they shared a lot of cards together.
Right.
And you would see her coming down to go and support him at the time when they was dating and stuff, so... Big shout out to Miss Banks.
Lawrence Okoli. Yeah. I'm excited about seeing what he does.
Yeah, he's doing his thing. World champion. He just done put out a book and all this kind of stuff.
He's put out a song, bro.
Yeah, he's got
man's rapping in that
now.
He does his own entrance music.
Though, isn't it? He's like,
I'm
like, right.
Coming with that gig swag.
He's got that gigs energy.
Yeah. coming with that brain lock vibe.
Oh, yeah.
Take it back.
Taking it back.
For those watching who don't know, that Dan Blake used to be a rapper called Brain Lock.
Yeah, trust me. Nick, you used to rap as well, though. I know you did as well.
Yeah, but we're talking way back now, bro. We're talking.
You used to battle rap, though, didn't you?
Well, no, not really. Like my brother battle rapped.
And
he was really good. He was like the jump off champion, flop champion.
Oh my days.
He was really good, but like, you know, I What I used to try, but you know, weren't very good.
What kind of MC star were you anyway? What kind of vibe were you? Like, what was your
not very
vibe?
Good.
Yeah, I feel you. Me too. That's why I don't rap anymore. But anyway, back to a bit of boxing. I had to bring out more vintage from the collection.
Yeah, what's going on here?
I just got like memorabilia from these stadium events that I used to work at and just have a nosy at. So you've got Joshua Povetkin.
Okay.
Original programming, you see.
Yeah.
Then we've got the
this
one,
is a big one. Yeah,
Joshua.
Yeah.
Klitschko's a bit tattered, as you can see, but well, there we go. It survived.
That's from Wembley.
Yeah, official program from Wembley Stadium. Joshua, I got about three of them at home actually.
I remember where I was. Yeah. Was that when was that fight?
It was April. Wembley Stadium, April 29th. Yeah.
I was in Birmingham. I was in a restaurant in Birmingham having a curry.
Interesting.
I was working on an event and there was loads of us there, and I'm just like on the phone. Watching this fight, and I'm like, what? Like just like getting gassed watching it.
And I was like trying to drag staff away from watching the event for free. And they were running in to go watch it.
Yeah,
and
you
I'm
can't
like,
see nothing.
Yeah,
though,
but I'm like, yeah, guys, come back. And I'm there like,
you're trying to watch it as well.
And I'm like, oh, AJ, get up, come on. And AJ gets dropped.
Yeah.
Then you hear the whole stadium shakes and you can hear the count. One, two, and you can hear everyone like, get up, get
but bro,
up.
When you're watching that, where were you?
I was on level one, Wembley Stadium, level one.
But surely they look like two little ants.
They,
like,
yeah, they do. They do, but like the atmosphere, bro, it's on another level. But the only atmosphere that beats that match is when I was working for Carl Froch's fight at Wembley. It's the first one at Wembley and Groves when it was 90,000. I was there that day, and when I think it was when Groves got dropped in the end, the whole stadium shook. I swear down, like it was like an earthquake.
What, cheering? Or
like, just when he was dropped, like, just the cheer, the roar, like, oh, like, you know when someone gets knocked out? Like, oh, and then it ending so quick and then everybody rushing out. But just, like, when it ends, the final countdown, and then the atmosphere is like, wow.
The
like,
final countdown. Big tune.
All right, no PRS in that. But, yeah, just like... Hearing a stadium shake is crazy, to think that's even possible. But it's it's like an earthquake, man.
I've never been to a stadium boxing match, actually.
Really?
I've been to boxing matches in arenas.
Yeah, arenas.
But like,
yeah.
I've never been to an outdoor one.
Yeah. Like, that day, I remember just saying, like, I'm definitely going to book in the shift that day. to go for that Joshua Klitschko. But good memories. But going on to what's going on now in the heavyweight division, Tyson Fury against AJ, that's been a complete shambles.
It's not happening, is it?
Absolute shambles. People are saying that basically that Tyson didn't even want the fight at all anyway.
It's hard, we can all speculate and say, this person didn't want the fight and blah, blah, blah. But what's frustrating from my perspective is it's what the fans wanted to see.
Yes,
you've dangled the carrot now.
Carrot got dangled.
And all of us are just pissed. Because, we don't want to see... I think Usyk Joshua would be a good fight, don't get me wrong.
Yeah, very good fight. But risky.
But we don't really want to see it.
Yeah, we don't.
Maybe we would have wanted to see it before they told us that we could have had Joshua Fury.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it's the same for... The worst one for me is Wilder.
Fury free. What do you think the outcome is? Because I feel like he's training for a different style, Jojo, I see. He's training for a different style, where I feel like he wants to get more uppercuts in and move around. But I feel like Fury's going to come again with the same kind of aggression and be too much. Too overwhelming for him. He's just too overwhelming. Yeah. He's too opposing.
Fury's a spoiler, isn't he? That's what he does.
He's a
spoiler. His style is like, he gets right in your face and like...
posing.
And then because he's big.
Yeah, he's huge. Yeah,
he's a tall guy. He wears you out by kind of holding and and like getting in the clinch and all of that stuff. So it's like, Wilder was knackered. Do you know what I mean?
He's only got one trigger. He's only got that one right hand.
I don't want to hear all of that. Yeah. You know, the costume weighed too much and that's why I was tired. It's like, no, bruv, you were tired because you were fighting a man who's 6'9" who was leaning on you.
Yeah, that's the reality. That's the reality of the situation. And he only had a couple of tricks up his sleeve.
Yeah.
It was that right hand all the time. And he's got to have more to his game, because if you back him up, which Fury was doing, there's no other game
but
after
you
back
boxer.
Him up.
That's what, like, yeah. he's never going to outbox Tyson Fury.
That's what he's training to do at the moment. I see him training.
That would be like me taking up boxing tomorrow. bro, training for a year and thinking I can outbox somebody.
Yeah.
Like, you have to be doing it for years.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah,
years.
Yeah. It's to not going to be have that. Yeah, it's not going to be. I don't feel he's going to have enough in mind wise. It's not going to sink in.
Look, the only way. The only way. That Deontay Wilder wins the fight is with the bingo punch.
Yeah, the bingo punch. If it's got to land out of nowhere.
The only way. Yeah. He's not winning the fight on points.
Yeah.
Forget it. Because he lost the first fight on points. Yeah. That whole draw stuff. Oh, but he had the 10-8 round, blah, blah, blah. Even with the 10-8 rounds, Fury wiped the floor with him.
And Fury, even when he got knocked down, he came back up and started finishing him off with a jab and ended the round convincingly.
The boxing skills, it's a different level.
Yeah,
you know phenomenal. What I mean? So, phenomenal. You know, I wouldn't say this to his face. So if you're watching, don't come for me, bro. But like the facts are, if it comes down to points, there's no way Deontay Wilder can win the fight, in my opinion. He's got to win it by a decision.
He's not a point. You know, knockout. Yeah, for sure.
But
when he puts weight on, it doesn't even, he makes him more a bit, I feel like when he puts weight on, he's even a bit sluggish. So I feel like he's best when he's looser, even like when he comes in at about 210, 215. I don't, a heavier Deontay, that's what he tried to come in for the fight against Fury.
Because Fury's big. Yeah. So like he thought, oh, I'm going to try and match him up. But
no chance. You're a natural, he's even a natural cruiserweight himself.
Fury's a bit of a freak of nature in that, like, 100%. He's such a big guy and like, not fat. He's not like he was fat. Obviously, we've all seen him
in flesh.
But like, I've seen him.
Yeah,
in
sports so like, what is he massive? Massive, like, yes. There we go.
Like,
you confirmed it. Yeah.
Like, but he's not like he's not one of these chiseled boxers.
Yeah,
you know
what
I mean? He don't have the like ripped body and all of that stuff. But he's still he's big, but he's fast.
Yeah,
you noticed that.
Imagine that, a big man that quick.
He's fast. He can like nip in and out, bang bang. Like you know, and I think that just. A lot of that is natural ability and natural talent, but it's also just like the background that he's come from, you know, being from a gypsy background and stuff like that.
Yeah.
He's grown up fighting
yeah,
you know
that whole
I mean?
Culture.
Like he's a fighting man.
And
he's got the talent to back it as well.
Mm.
So, you know, I think if it's a trilogy fight between those two, I think Fury wins it. And then we see what happens from there. But, you know, I was listening to Steve Bunce, Mike Costello on Radio 5
podcast,
Live the other day, Costello and Bunce, big up those
podcast,
guys.
Yeah.
And Bunce was saying, you know, the chances of seeing them two fight each other, it's gone. The unification fight is gone now.
I think it'll come, 2022.
No,
maybe.
But it won't be for all the belts, because the belts all move around because, you know, mandatory challenges, and then you have to give up a belt if you don't want to do the mandatory and blah, blah, blah. This was the opportunity for all four belts to be up for grabs on one fight, and it's gone.
Like, it's a good point.
And that's infuriating. And this is why, like, I don't like... I understand why all the different belts are there. Like, I get it. Because, you know, the different sanctioning bodies came out and blah, blah, blah. But, like, all the different organisations, you know what I mean. WBC, WBO, IBF, you know, WBA, blah, blah, blah. Like, but I just think there should be one title.
Yeah, that's one.
Just one
definitive title.
But the problem is the genie's out of the bottle now, and it's hard. It's too hard to put it back in.
Yeah.
You can't say, because then who becomes the one? Mm. You know.
But I feel like the most special belt and the most well-renowned belt is the WBC.
Yeah,
it's just got that glamour. Everyone wants that green
Tyson
strap
with that round his waist is the picture. Ain't
He's the guy after that win. You know, just dominant in merit, going out on the away team. Like he's always done. That's where I'm like, I want to see.
You on about Tyson Fury or Mike Tyson here? I was on about Mike Tyson.
Oh, you on about Mike Tyson?
Yeah. Mike Tyson
salute
with a WBC strap.
Legend.
Like massive. But like, I just think there should be one flipping title.
Yeah.
And that way you don't get all this bullshit. Because everybody wants to be.
Interim belts and
all of a sudden you will see. Because boxing's been like it for years. People dodging people because they don't want to like lose
their
title.
Money.
Listen. You will see people desperate to fight the guy as soon as there's only one belt because they want the belt.
Yeah, exactly.
They can't get no other belt and be like, I'm the world champ because I got this belt. Well, you might have one world championship, but like that guy's got three. Like, you know, so.
All right, then. Regan, let's do some quick predictions. You know, we can, so these are scenario fights. Jojo, feel free to jump in. Let's just do a quick roundup of all these up and coming fights that could happen in the heavyweight division. I'm going to throw a complete curveball out there. Yeah. Cool. This one that could happen. Joshua fights Usyk. I think they're in talks now to sign the contract. You know, don't quote me. I don't know, but they're in talks, so I'm hearing. All right, Usyk beats Joshua, becomes the unified champion, all the belts. Wilder beats Fury. We've got an undisputed fight between
those
maybe
two.
Wilder and Usyk. How about that? Did anyone look at that scenario? I haven't heard anybody mention that scenario.
Nobody wants that scenario.
But it is a possibility, right?
Yeah, yeah.
It's a possibility, but that's not making any money.
Nah.
Big possibility, though. Usyk. Yeah. I'm just telling you, Usyk is a very, very dangerous fighter. The footwork, the non-stop pressure, relentless pressure. Like, dangerous man.
But he's small, bruv. Like, in comparison to Anthony Joshua.
He beat
the money, man.
Yeah, give what? Oh, that step aside, not happening.
Because the thing is, he asked for 20, you know, he's not going to get 20 million.
Yeah, no, he's not going to get.
$20 million.
Yeah. So. He's gone in at 20, you go in at 10, and then we meet somewhere in the middle.
But like, what Eddie Hearn was saying was that Bob Arum didn't even want to negotiate. As soon as they made the announcement, he was like, yep, yeah, don't worry, we're going to fight Wilder, then we'll come back. He didn't even make an effort to do the step aside.
About that, right? Yeah. Like, Bob Arum, and I say this respectfully, like, you know, Bob Arum is a guy that has been around for a very long time. Yeah,
definitely.
How old is he? Like, in his 90s?
90s, yeah. Yeah, he's a guy strong, though.
He's a guy that's been around for a very long time. So I'm like, no, seriously, though, on a level, I'm like, I don't know how the nicest way to say this is, but like, you know, you've not got long left in life.
Yeah,
it's like, enjoy that fight now. Why are you waiting? Like, squabbling over, because you probably won't see it. Yeah. Like, if I'm being real, you know, if that was me, if I'm trying to put myself in Bob Arum's shoes, if I'm 90 and you know, I've had this amazing, illustrious career in boxing, this is the fight now.
Mm.
This Fury Joshua is the fight.
That we want to see.
Just make it happen.
That's what we want to see. Like, and the thing is, it's not like that it's complicated to pay this man the step aside money. From the fight that he's going to fight against Fury, he's probably going to make about maybe $11 million to $12 million. $20 million, I'm not, obviously it's a lot of money, but I'm just saying between
Fury's camp, the organisations,
the camp, everybody can pitch in and get my man the step aside money, Deontay Wilder. Let's get it on.
Let me tell you, the Saudi money.
Yeah.
Like, that is $20 million. It's literally like finding a quid. Yeah. To some of these men there, you know what I mean?
But I was watching an hour-long interview with Eddie Hearn on IFL, and the defining reason, what seems why this fight didn't happen, is because Bob Arum, as soon as that got announced, they didn't try and even go to the step-aside money. They just signed the contracts for Wilder, Fury 3. You saw Fury sign online.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's when people were saying there was something fishy going on, because why are you so quick to sign these contracts right away and not negotiate the step-aside money?
Well, people said there was something fishy going on all along, innit? Like, when you know, Fury knew all along that he was going to have to fight Wilder, but it was just all, you know, all talk and
using
that.
Using AJ's name, apparently, to kind of build hype.
What don't
again.
Sit well with me is, like, them then going on to argue on social media.
Oh, that was
like,
that was neat,
I get it, because some people like the banter on social media and blah, blah. I'm just like, guys, you ain't, like, if the fight's not going to happen, this is just pointless.
Yeah, I didn't want to see AJ do that. I was like, oh, AJ, man, you don't really talk much like that anyway. So I'd see you on Twitter doing that. I was like, allow it, man. But I hopefully they come back. But quick predictions, though. So if Wilder was to fight Usyk, who would win that one?
Wilder.
Who would win AJ Usyk?
AJ.
Okay. Who would win? Work on JoJo jumping.
I don't respect Usyk as a heavyweight.
AJ? Me neither.
AJ? Like, all right, cool. No, don't have to say your story. This is real opinion. Wilder, Usyk?
Wilder.
Okay, cool. All right, then moving on. AJ Fury. What are we saying, guys? Let's go there. Straight in, innit?
I think Fury takes it.
Fury, I respect that. Me personally, I think I feel like I've got sitting on the fence is so weird. I've got like two.
You
defining...
can't put the question to me and then sit on the fence.
All right, then I'm going with AJ.
Why?
Because I said it on my last. Didn't I say it on the last podcast? I said he would do him with the uppercut. The way AJ has been practicing that uppercut, I thought that would be the weapon that ends it. The same way he got Klitschko, I think he'll get Fury with it. But if he can get close enough and meet Fury with
so
the aggression.
Slippery, bruv. This is the thing, though.
It's the athleticism of AJ that will get him through if he can just, like, channel it.
He doesn't have the athleticism.
We've seen
No, he
it.
Does. I'm not talking about the stamina.
Bro.
I'm talking about the Olympic.
Bro, the Olympic
caliber.
And I get what you're saying, right? But,
but
in the two fights that he had with Ruiz Jr., right? I know he lost the first one. Let's put that one aside for the minute.
That was nerves in New York.
Yeah, but it's nerves, but it's also because he thought it was a gimme. Like, you know, you're fighting... No, real talk, though. You're fighting this guy who hasn't had a proper camp. Like, you know, a big guy. You're thinking, I'm going to drop this guy easy, you know what I mean?
That was a mad fight.
I'm chiseled. I'm undefeated.
It's like a horror movie.
I'm the guy, and he lost the fight, right? But the second fight, even... when he boxed Ruiz,
yeah.
It weren't a masterclass for me.
No. It was just in and out.
It was okay, but it weren't like Fury levels. And so the point I'm trying to make is that if Fury can outbox Deontay Wilder and avoid Wilder's missile punch, which we know he's got a bigger missile punch than Joshua.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah,
facts. Definitely. Yeah. Right. Why can't Fury do that same tactic to Joshua?
Yeah, because I feel with AJ, he's got the Olympic caliber and he's more skilled as a fighter naturally than Deontay Wilder. Wilder hasn't got different dimensions like AJ's got, you know. He's a better boxer.
Yeah,
AJ's got a better 1-2. He's got better combinations. AJ's like one of the only solid heavyweight combination fighters that are throwing combinations in a fight properly, like throwing uppercuts, throwing 1-2s, double jabs. AJ's going at it. And even the fight against Pulev, look at the stuff he was working on in that fight. He's learning on the job.
Yeah.
But he was working on all sorts in that fight.
But I feel like nobody talks about AJ's big performances like it was a masterclass. Nobody goes, AJ was it was a classy, AJ's biggest performances are still his knockouts.
Yeah, but that's what we know him for. He's about knocking you out. That's where AJ's at his best. Him on the back foot against bloody Andy Ruiz. That is not AJ
Andy Ruiz. Disrespect. No,
sorry.
Andy Ruiz.
I don't want no beef, bro. Don't punch me up when you see me.
You're saying that I'm the guy here saying Joshua's got no chance. Yo, bro, don't take it personally.
But you know what, bro? But we don't want to see AJ on the back foot, do we? AJ's known for coming at you with them knockouts, coming to do business. So I feel like he's gonna meet that aggression with Fury. Believe that. I believe he will meet that aggression with Fury.
This is why. Can I just say as well on camera? This England top is ridiculously tight.
He's like, hench though. Like, you can see the henchness coming out.
It's the tightness of the top. Also, not as hench as Jojo behind the camera.
Jojo just dense.
Jesus Christ, my guy's traps.
That's my security. But you know that's my security guard though. You didn't know
the
this.
Traps going on behind there.
He's on tab. You pay him like £50 an hour. Yeah.
This guy should get in the ring with Anthony Joshua. Fucking hell.
Yeah, so there we go. Jojo, you didn't give a prediction? AJ Fury? I've gone with AJ. Yeah.
If it's
by knockout.
If it's on points, Fury. If it's a knockout, then AJ.
Yeah. AJ, for me, the only way AJ wins the fight is the same way that Wilder wins the fight.
Yeah.
He has to knock him out. If it goes to points, there's no heavyweight out there that can beat Tyson Fury.
Yeah. But again, I feel that Fury, he will not, with this trainer that he has, Sugar Hill, that whole camp and the way they train, they're not known for taking fights on points. He's coming to meet aggression. If Sugar Hill's training him, he's coming for an aggressive fight. He's coming to knock AJ out. So they're going to meet fire with fire, and it's going to be someone's getting knocked out. So if Fury wins, it's by knockout as well. That's what I feel.
You think?
Yeah, because he's Sugar Hill. That's that whole camp. That's what they train for. His whole gym and his father, rest in peace, their legacy of the Sugar Hill and that whole training philosophy is coming at you, pressure fighting, crunk style, they call it, crunk style. Hope I pronounced it right, but they're coming at you to aggressively knock you out and win the fight, and that's the style that he incorporated against Wilder this time around. Because what was it, Ben Davison was a trainer before, Ben Davison, he was a back foot fighting. You know, he was doing traditional Fury, which we know him for. We didn't know Fury for doing this kind of aggressive fighting, coming at you on the front foot, meeting fire with fire. Mm. We'd never seen this from Fury. So when he done it so convincingly against Wilder, what's making him going to change now?
The issue is, you know, when you're a heavyweight, you've got to be careful, mate. Because, you know, one punch and it's lights out, you know. Like, it's different when you're them lightweights.
That's
why I don't like watching lightweight fights. Them lot are like smacking each other in the face and not even, they don't even do nothing. They don't even go. And when they do get knocked down, they just get back up again.
Yeah.
Get smacked in the face some more.
So you're not liking the weights I'm loving the welterweight division. Honourable shout out to former guest, one of the first guests of Sports at Blake, Chris Congo. He's out. Big up Josh Taylor, who just became the undisputed lightweight champion of the world. Let's give him a shout out.
Come on. Can I just say, like, on the record, I'm not taking anything away from any boxer.
It's a tough sport.
Like, I could never do it.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, from a from a viewer's perspective, yeah. there's a reason why the heavyweights are the ones that attract the most attention.
One knockout,
because,
isn't it?
Yeah, because most of the time fights end in brutal KOs, don't they?
Brutal KOs. And let's give an honourable shout out to Dillon White, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. He's a guy, he had a fantastic win against Povetkin.
I was gutted for Dillon, though, when he lost the first one. Because it's he basically put himself in a position where if he beat Povetkin in that fight, he was the WBC mandatory, wasn't he? And he'd get the shot that he so richly deserves. Yeah. And he just fell at the last hurdle. And that is the brutality of heavyweight boxing, not in the physical side of it, in the mental side of it as well. You know, you've been in the box seat for so long, and then it gets taken away just
training
like that. But
away.
Hopefully he'll get a shot, like, you know.
Yeah, it'd be criminal if Dillon White. Let me say something. It's criminal if this guy doesn't get a shot. How can you have a man that's just been taking challenger after challenger in the heavyweight division?
Risks as well, yeah.
Risks, even when he doesn't even have to take a risk. He can sit on his backside and chill. But he's taking fights to support his team and all the entourage of fighters that he's bringing through at the same time. That people, if they look at what he's doing and noticing, he's bringing up a lot of fighters under his wing at the same time. So he's continuing to build business and have fights, and he still hasn't had a shot. I'm like, come on, give the man his chance.
It's coming. You know? It's just politics, though, isn't it?
Politics, for real. Boxing's a lot of politics, man. Some of these fights.
Match room as well, now as well. You know, like, that complicates the issue because.
Do you think?
When he fought Joshua the first time, he weren't with Matchroom.
He wasn't. He was independent them times, right? But then don't you think, Jojo, he should have... So then people say that, right, you wanted your shot. Why didn't you take the fight at Wembley when AJ offered it to you? Remember that one?
Yeah.
Remember that one?
He was saying they weren't offering him enough money, though, innit?
So you're thinking, what, is it money over titles? What are we saying here, then? Because it's like...
Oh, it's always money.
It's always money. Interesting.
Any dispute is always money.
But then it's interesting. But that was a time where people would say could combat like you, but you offered a shot though. You didn't take the shot though. That was at Wembley again, 80,000-90,000.
It's money, but it's also respect. I think as well. Like he probably saw it as a disrespectful trait to not offer him what he feels like he's worth in the fight.
Worth.
You know what I mean? Like so it does come down to that as well. And it's easy for us to sit here and say like, if you really wanted the fight, you should have took it, blah, blah, blah. But like if someone's really undervaluing you in any job, in any aspect of life.
You
want to
get paid right.
Trust me.
Violent sport. Big respect. Yeah.
Like, even, like, for me, and for you, Dan, if someone said to you, can you do a voiceover for me? There's two of you that are going to be doing this voiceover. Steve is getting paid, you know, £1 million, and we're going to give you, like, £20. You're going to be like, whoa, hang on, like, you know, and like, so it's kind of like that, you know, it's slightly different because you're getting punched in the face several times whilst it's happening, you know.
Honourable, so, we talk boxing, you know, it's been, we talk football.
We talk Euros, which is why I'm in this children's Euros top, children's England top. Swear it weren't this tight the last time I wore it, you know, the gym must be working.
Blame
still,
it on lockdown, you know what I mean? But you're in the gym, your guns out, you know. Bro, just talk about like what you've been, I see you've been all over the TV, CBBC, running around doing your thing. Just promote and let people know where they can catch you in the radio show and TV stuff, man.
So, the CBBC thing, I was just guesting on Saturday Mashup. So it's like, it's a Saturday morning kids TV show and I almost got gunged. Thankfully, I didn't. Because that would have been a mazza in my hair, but I avoided that, so that was cool. But on the radio, like I do, obviously One Extra on a Saturday, 10 till 1, and then on a Sunday, even though the football season's about to finish, so it might all change next year. I don't know, but as things are at the moment, I do the squad on a Sunday, which is kind of like talking about football, which you can get on BBC Sounds as well. That's probably
really
the best place to go. And then just social media, Instagram, Nick Bright.
Yeah, Nick Bright, he's all over it, simple, doing his thing. And yeah, bro, just like, you know, it's always been a long time to catch up and it's been a pleasure, man.
Yeah.
Just having you hanging out, talking sports and that. We must do it again, man.
In all honesty, we tried to make it happen. We've been trying to make it happen for ages. Yeah. And then like, you know, schedules change. And because of COVID, it's like even more difficult to see people. But, you know, as things are, we're less than a month away now, away from apparently the end of...
Yeah.
The restrictions.
No masks, hopefully, as well.
All
like.
Of that is meant to be coming to an end in it. Less than a month. So we'll see what happens, innit?
Yeah, you know, this is it, man.
Maybe we'll be able to to actually, I don't know, see each other without it being so like regimented you've got to sit here, and if you want to go to the toilet, you've got to put your mask on, and like,
you're forgetting your mask every second. You know what I mean?
Oh, bro, I know we're trying to wrap, but we're like a year and a half into this pandemic, and every time I walk out my house to go to get on the tube, I have to turn back because I forgot my mask. It's so annoying. How have I not learnt this yet?
Bro, I feel you, man. It's like, and you're losing them as well, dropping out your pocket and all that kind of stuff. But yeah, bro. So Sports with Blake podcast. It's been episode 2. It's been a pleasure to have Nick Bright in the studio. Let's have a round of applause.
Thank you very much, bro. Thank you.
Pleasure.
Sports with Blake.
On Dan Blake TV on YouTube.
Dan meets sports fanatics and some of the biggest sports entertainment stars.